Hachette Audio presents La La Lovely, The Art of Finding Beauty in the Everyday, written and read by Trina McNeilly. This program includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of images. To the ones who have offered and exemplified true beauty in my life. In memory of Hilda Tompkins, my grandma, the beauty of wisdom and hope. For Cynthia Tompkins, my mom, the beauty of grace and selfless love. Amy Tompkins, my sister, the beauty of creativity and dreaming. Ella McNeilly, my daughter, the beauty of being a beloved daughter who has found her voice and uses it. The sweetest thing in all my life has been the longing to find the place where all beauty came from. C.S. Lewis, Till We Have Faces.
Foreword. Everyone needs a friend like Trina. I've known this gem for 20 years. She's my go-to girl on all things fashion, makeup, jewelry, denim, and yes, I even FaceTimed her when picking out a living room chandelier. We've trekked through London in the rain, decorated my New York apartment for a Land of Nod photo shoot, shared a favorite author, Andrew Murray, and learned how to make meringue. I still haven't mastered that last one, to be honest. She is everything she says she is. There's no pomp and circumstance, no over-embellishment, no voice of bravado. Instead, Trina's words are a gentle hug, or hygge, as she describes later. They comfort and console, dripping with wisdom, the fruit of finding beauty in the rubble. She's helped me dig through my own rubble. A few years ago, during a season of panic attacks, Trina texted me these words out of the blue. I'll give you a full life in the emptiest of places. Firm muscles, strong bones. You'll be like a well-watered garden, a gurgling spring that never runs dry. You'll use the old rubble of past lives to build anew, rebuild the foundations from out of your past. You'll be known as those who can fix anything, restore old ruins, rebuild and renovate. Make the community livable again. Isaiah 58, The Message. For most of us, there comes a moment where we face the sting of heartache, rejection, or pain. For some, the memories are loud and literal. For others, the reminders are subtle, or worse, silent. In response, we numb out, point fingers, or sometimes both. If only it were that simple. But blame cannot be acutely named. There are always more layers to the story. Nevertheless, we unravel. Perhaps you've lost love, legacy, or hope. There is nothing so ugly it cannot be beautiful. There is nothing so wounded it cannot be healed. There is nothing so painful you cannot recover. There is nothing so lost it cannot be found. When you unravel, you always rebuild. When life strays from the dandelion wishes of our youth, Trina helps us answer the question, how do we respond? She leads us on a scavenger hunt for the loveliest of survivors, determined to find redemption in the ruin. The wisdom found here is chock full of beauty and grace, redemption and restoration. I cried precious tears of remembrance of God's faithfulness page after page. What a comfort to know our Father in heaven, love himself, always protects, trusts, hopes, and perseveres. Survivors make the most beautiful people. They know where they've been, where they're headed, and most importantly, that they're loved. And like Trina, they know how to lead others, people like you and me, forward. Rebekah Lyons, author, You Are Free, and Free Fall to Fly.
Introduction beautiful spaces and broken places. Sometimes beauty is so deep it pierces us with longing. For what? For life as it was meant to be. Beauty reminds us of an Eden we have never known, but somehow know our hearts were created for. Beauty speaks of heaven to come, when all shall be beautiful. It haunts us with eternity. John and Stacy Eldridge. Captivating. I have this habit of looking for the lovely. Some days I find it in perfectly styled spaces, and other days I find it in the broken places. Some days I do the finding, and other days beauty finds me. And during the long, dark winters where I live, just northwest of Chicago, it's more like mining. It's digging. It's discovering. But no matter the day or season, beauty is there, just waiting to be found, to be noticed, to be uncovered. It's not beyond the laundry pile, chipped paint, dirty dishes, broken table, or broken life. It's right in the center of it. There is beauty in your green toile patterned plates crusted over with last night's spaghetti dinner. There is beauty in the white paint peeling off the side of the house that you can't afford to have fixed. There is beauty stuffed between the mountains of sweaty socks and stained shirts on your laundry room floor. Yes, there is even beauty to be found in your broken life that shows no promise of being put together again. I've always had an eye for beautiful things. I just never knew it. I called it good taste. I inherited it from my parents, who exemplified class. My little sister, Amy, is the creative one in my family, the baby, the free spirit, the one who graduated from the Art Institute of Chicago. I'm the oldest, the predictable one who plays by the rules and makes a lot of plans, the one who prides herself on and is weighed down by responsibility, the one others assume has it all figured out, the opposite end of the spectrum. It was my sister who taught me that we are all creative, every one of us. How could we not be? We are children of the Creator. Over time, I slowly began to believe that yes, I did in fact have an eye for finding beauty, and that it was inherent. This ability to find and create beauty is an attribute that the Creator wove into each and every one of us. Beauty points us to God, and expressing it points others to Him. When I began blogging 10 years ago, I didn't have a goal or end game. I had simply found a place to share my words, imagery, ideas, inspiration, information, and life. My blog was a place to collect all of my gatherings. At the time, I had two little ones and spent most of my time at home. And as it turned out, that is where I found beauty. In things that pertain to the home. It was practical, and it became my pattern to collect and catalog images that I found beautiful. Eventually, I began sharing images of my own home. Photos of my perfectly imperfect life were pinned and repinned, rooms that were perfectly styled spaces. But behind the photo was real life, of course. Crying kids who didn't want to comply, messy piles pushed aside in another room, and a broken heart that no pretty picture could crop out. While I spent my days sharing beauty, redecorating my home, looking for lovely things, and sharing my finds, home as I had always known it fell apart. Just shy of 40 years of marriage, my parents got divorced. It shocked me and shattered my heart. To complicate the matter, I live in my childhood home, which is a museum of memories. It has been 6 very long years of grieving. Grieving family, grieving what once was, grieving what could have been. I had never truly had my heart broken, and I never suspected that someone else's breakup could break me. But it can. It did. I found it ironic, almost cruel, that I would have to journey through this dismantling of home in the very place where my definition of home was first defined. The first year of the divorce process, I couldn't even tell you that I was broken. I knew my family was fractured. However, I didn't realize I was. It took a friend telling me that I had a broken heart. She named it, connecting the physical and emotional like numbered dots in a coloring book, and gave me permission to stop pretending that I was okay when I was not. I carried a newborn in my arms, an 18-month-old on my hip, and on my shoulders, the weight of the unknown.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.